गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, आई एम डॉक्टर मोनिका खेतरपाल, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर ऑफ फिजिक्स, गवर्नमेंट डूंगर कॉलेज, बीकानेर। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिलीवर अ लेक्चर ऑन सुपरकंडक्टिविटी। दिस इज अ टॉपिक ऑफ एमएससी फाइनल फिजिक्स। इन माय प्रीवियस लेक्चर्स आई हैव टॉट यू द बेसिक डेफिनेशंस ऑफ सुपरकंडक्टिविटी, क्राइटेरिया ऑफ सुपरकंडक्टर्स एंड मेसनर इफेक्ट। Now, first of all, I am going to give a brief description what I have taught you earlier. Earlier, I have taught that superconductors are the materials which possess infinite conductivity. Infinite conductivity means zero resistivity. This superconductivity is temperature dependent property. These materials are superconductors below a certain temperature called critical temperature, and above this temperature they behave as normal materials. It is not important that all good conductors are superconductors. For example, silver, which is a good conductor, but it cannot be superconductor even by varying the temperature. I have also discussed an important effect, that is Meissner effect. Meissner effect states that when a superconductor is placed inside a magnetic field, the value of magnetic induction B will be zero inside the superconductor, whether it is simply connected or multiply connected. That means if we place a superconductor in a magnetic field, flux lines will be outside the superconductor. Inside the superconductor, there will be no flux. This is a very important property of superconductors, a magnetic field dependent property. Now, in connection to this, I am going to derive today and another important equations. These are London equations. These show the variation of magnetic field when a superconductor is placed in it. This theory is based on two fluid model, which was initially used for liquid helium. London used this two fluid model for superconductor. As we know that superconductivity is temperature dependent phenomena, so there are two parts of superconductor according to temperature dependence: a normal behavior and second is the superconducting behavior. Hence, a superconductor can be thought to be composed of normal electrons and super electrons. That is, it is a two fluid. One fluid is normal electrons and the other fluid is superconducting electrons. Hence, there are two fluids, normal electrons and other being the superconducting electrons. These concentration, normal and superconducting electron concentration, is a temperature dependent behavior. As we have stated, below TC the material will be superconductor, and below TC when we approach to 0 Kelvin, superconducting behavior is dominant. That means at 0 Kelvin superconducting electrons are maximum, but on increasing the temperature it is observed that up till TC the ratio of normal to superconducting electron increases, and since at TC material becomes normal, so at TC all electrons are normal. Hence, there is a variation in concentration of superconducting electrons and normal electrons with the variation of temperature. This is depicted in the graph. Here on y-axis I have plotted the concentration of normal electrons, which I have denoted as NN. This is the fraction of electrons in the normal state. And on this axis, I have plotted NS. This is the concentration of superconducting electrons. And on x-axis, I have plotted temperature. I have plotted the graph in the temperature range 0 to Tc. I have assumed that total density of both the electrons, that is superconducting electrons and normal electrons, to be equal to 1. Hence, Nn plus Ns will be equal to 1, according to our assumption. Now, it is a temperature dependent property. Initially, I am taking T equal to Tc. At T equal to Tc, material is normal, so concentration of normal electrons will be equal to the total concentration. And total concentration is assumed to be 1. Hence, Nn will be 1, and material is since normal, so density of superconducting electrons is 0. This is depicted in the graph. Here at Tc, the graph shown of Ns is equal to 0, and the graph shown of Nn show a maxima. And at T equal to 0 Kelvin, that means this point, here the total concentration will be equal to of superconducting electrons, and the total concentration is assumed to be 1, so Ns will be equal to 1. And all electrons are superconducting, so Nn will be equal to 0. This is also evident from the graph. Here, the graph starts from Nn equal to 0, and for Ns, the graph is equal to 1, that is maximum. And in the temperature range 0 to Tc, both type of electrons have a contribution. Nn plus Ns both contribute, but the total concentration will be equal to 1. Since there are two type of electrons, and electrons are the carrier of electrical current, so there will be electrical current in a superconducting material. But we know that because of superconducting electrons, the resistance offered to the flow of current is 0. Hence, all the current will be mainly because of these superconducting electrons. Hence, the normal electrons are ignored. Only the contribution of superconducting electrons will be taken. On the basis of this two fluid model, we are now going to derive two London important equations. For these London equations, we are taking our superconducting material to be placed inside an electric field. The electric field intensity is assumed here to be E. Using the equation of motion of superconducting electrons, which are accelerated by electric field E, the equation of motion is expressed as, this is the force, mass into acceleration. Acceleration is expressed as dvs upon dt, and the force in the electric field is qe. The charge of the electron is negative. This q is expressed as minus e. So this first expression denotes the equation of motion of superconducting electrons in electric field. As I have already stated that normal electrons are ignored, so we have only used superconducting electrons. That's why this Vs is written. This Vs is the velocity of electrons. Now, using the current density of superconducting electrons, Js, as we know, Js is minus Ns E Vs. Now, I am differentiating this expression. Differentiating this expression, here the variable is Vs, so we get dJs upon dt to be equal to this value. Putting the value of dVs upon dt from the first expression, I got the expression expressed as equation 2. This is the London first expression. The London first expression denotes the variation of current density with time. Now I am going to derive London's second expression. The London's second expression is derived using the first expression. From this first expression, I get electric field E2B equal to, expressed as third expression. This is our first London equation. Now I am going to use this electric field by taking the curl. Taking curl of this expression, I got the fourth expression. I am going to couple the London equation and Maxwell equation. Using the Maxwell third expression, which uses electric field as well as magnetic field. Magnetic field intensity being B, I am using the third equation, curl E plus del B by del T equal to 0. So coupling fourth expression with this Maxwell expression, I got this expression, which is here I have shown as equation 5. Differential with respect to time of a factor equal to 0. I am integrating this expression, and on integration, since we get constant of integration, I am assuming the constant of integration to be equal to 0. Using this expression, I got curl Js is equal to minus ns e square upon m b. This is the second London equation, which is curl Js is equal to minus ns e square upon m b. This expression shows the variation of Js, that is current density of superconducting electrons with distance. Earlier I have derived the first expression, which was to be the variation of current density with time. This is the first London expression. Dgs upon dt is equal to ns e square upon m. And finally, I have derived the second London expression, which is the variation of Js with distance, that is curl Js is equal to minus ns e square upon m b. These are two important equations which are derived by London. This shows the variation of current density inside a magnetic field. In my next lecture, I will compare these London equation with Meissner effect, which, as already I have stated, that they show that inside a superconductor, the magnetic field B will be zero. I hope you must have understood what I taught you today. Thank you, students, for listening to me. Thanks a lot.